Synrise started with a good arpeggio. That was a really hard time for us because we stopped working with our UK manager. We lost our UK label. And we were working on this second album that was so important to us because we had a lot of media attention, so that was really the album that we had to deliver.
We were using synthesizers already, but we were more using them like a guitar.
And then we became in a more calmer state of mind, and then we got really interested in more the character of sound and more sophisticated sounds, like lots of soundtrack vibes and lots of old stuff like Vangelis or old Depeche Mode.
We almost entered the 70s or the 80s. That was the intention, I think, to feel what they have felt with those instruments, and
it helped us to come up with new melodies.
But we still had the urge to dance and to give people energy.
That's probably also the first time we recorded live drums. With the first album also, because we didn't have any microphones, we used to plug every instrument straight into the computer.
Electronic music is cool because it's robotic, but we are a band in our core, so we always want to put some human vibe to it. In Synrise, there's, as you can hear, a cowbell who does like tick, 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 tick.
So simple and stupid. It works. It's literally like the singer counting 1, 2, 3, 4.
We wanted to use instruments that we never used before. So the timpani, for example, was like, okay, you could use soft synths or plugins or whatever, like digital instruments to recreate that sound. But we were like, no, we have to rent timpanis.
They were too large to bring them up the stairs to our old studio.
So it was like, okay, we're gonna use the small one and then pitch it down and then pitch it up.
We even tried some vocals. Mikael jammed on it and it was about something about the sun and the moon.
The original lyrics had something like, involved the sun and the moon and the beat of my heart.
So when we put the lead vocals on Synrise, it took away a bit of the vibe and the atmosphere, and it draws the listener into a certain emotion, into a certain box, and we didn't want that. We wanted to be free of any direction, so then we just simply muted it.
We just tried a really simple synth line, like you hear, and it was so easy, and we thought, oh, this is nothing. But then Bert hummed that melody. And it was really, it did something.
For Synrise, the vocal is done by Peaches, and the reason why it's Peaches is because in the first place, we really, really love her music.
No, she had a gig in Antwerp. So Dave and I looked at each other and said, okay, we have to go to Antwerp. Yeah, we went to the show. Afterwards, we got introduced to her in person in the backstage, and she had a day off, so that was perfect. She could sleep in Antwerp, take a cab, and come to Kortrijk to do the session.
Yeah, it's almost insulting to ask a person like Peaches to sing a three-note top line. We knew that, but we really loved her tonal voice, how she uses her voice as an instrument, really. This track from Dark Side of the Moon, Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon, The Great Gig in the Sky. And that track, there's a vocal, there's a woman singing just like a guitar solo. And she's not singing any words. And it's amazing, it still is. So that was the inspiration.
One day we just got an email from two directors from Stockholm. They said they were a huge fan of the album and that they wanted to make a video. Then we said, okay, but we have no money. And they were like, okay, well, give us the minimum and we'll just work with it. And with the minimum, they hired, I don't know, 15 people on set. They hired a massive car. What noemt die nu toe? Kuntag?
Is it a Ferrari? Maserati? No.
Lamborghini? Ne? Anne, Lotus.
Once the album was finished, we started to do promo gigs. So we packed our van and we drove to Amsterdam to do a radio session with a small audience. And we had the reaction that we had in mind was completely different. We had this arpeggio building, and then the drums started, then the bass came in, then the singer came on stage, and nothing happened. No excitement at all in the room. Everybody was just watching us and waiting for it to pass. And that was what Synrise was for a very long time. It was just an opener and nothing more.
I think most people didn't really understand the song.
We made a radio edit for Synrise and suddenly it was like people could understand what the track was. Suddenly there was definition. In the beginning I hated it because you need to have the time to get into the track and to to get in that trance vibe. So it was really hard to make that edit.
There's one remix that just stood out, and that was Solwax remix of Synrise. And it also came a couple of years later. They just sent us the remix. We didn't ask for the remix. There's also another version from a Belgian jazz player called Jeff Neve. He made a really nice piano version, which has his own live on YouTube now. From time to time, the song gets used in different areas, in film or like a Dior campaign. Years later, it got featured in the GTA on the Solwax radio station.
When we play live now, Synrise is the last song because it works really well, and because it became one of our main tracks for the audience, we give them it as a dessert.
It became the track of the audience.
I don't think we even ever tried to change it because it works perfect as it is, and I think we tried it a couple of times, but it never worked. It's somehow the original version is unbeatable. So we're gonna have to live with it for the rest of our lives.